Good evening. So some familiar faces. I want to apologize a little bit on the front end. Some of what you're going to see tonight will look familiar from the meeting on the 25th. I tried to mix it up a little bit. I thought about clip art. I did all those, but I decided I'll just keep it basic to the point and factual. But there are some additional slides. And part of that is kind of in response to some of the feedback that we've been hearing and some questions that I've been getting directly. I've had a chance to meet with several parents, and I've had a chance to also respond to some emails. And I hopefully at least some of the questions that have been out there to this point are either in here with some answers or in here as we understand that this is a question and that there's further work to do. So with that, I will just go ahead and take you through. I have condensed this a little bit from the other night, so the slides will look a little bit different, but the information is I think, all really the relevant information is all there. So thank you. All right, so tonight what I'd like to do is kind of give another overview of the information I provided on the 25th, talk about the background and the goals for what we're trying to do or what my recommendation is based on, a brief overview of the enrollment projection studies that have been done and the analysis that that has been done on those studies. There have been multiple studies done. And then also take a look at the options that have been considered or at least studied primarily by Habib, which is an architectural firm that did a study back in 2012. And then kind of get into what my recommendation would be. So I said it the other night, and I want to say it again tonight. You know, this is my recommendation. I came in here a little over 100 days ago now and really tried to look at everything that had been done. I was familiar that East was in the pipeline for a renovation project, talked to an awful lot of people, participated in the building committee work that was going on, and started to kind of land around or started to ask the question about, is there a way to, for us, as a school department, to leverage an already approved project, a project that was already approved by the state, that was going to consist of renovations only, is there a way for us to look at whether we can expand that project to also try to take care of some of the space issues that we are all familiar with that we have? So that conversation started really kind of early in the fall. There were a lot of discussions with a lot of different people, including the MSBA, about whether that was even a possibility. And the answer was yes, and that kind of led to an expansion of this recommendation, which I'll take you through in a little bit here. So a few things. From my perspective, I want to make sure that we're providing a recommendation that was educationally sound, that was timely, that was within a reasonable window period of time. I think the challenges that we face from a state of space perspective are in front of us. Our kids that are here now are the ones that are experiencing those challenges. Our teachers are the ones now, our parents experiencing it now. So how could we find a solution, a recommendation that would take care of the immediate and also provide a long-term relief in terms of space? I wanted to find something that really tried to address all grades, K through 12, because I think that all of us recognize, or those of you who have had the experience of going to the high school, for example, high school is 40 some odd years old. There are some not space constraints or space needs at the high school, but certainly the building itself is in need of some freshening up and trying to bring it in line with the programs that we currently have and that we're trying to offer. And then also, along with the fact that there are two separate issues. There's a space issue, and there's a actual capital improvement facility issue, and trying to separate those out. So they're related, but sometimes the funding mechanisms are different, and sometimes the solutions are different. And finally, it was very clear very early on that there was a real concern or a real priority to make sure we maintain our neighborhood schools. And in this proposal, I define that as 1 through 4. So some questions that have come up since January 25th. When is this going to happen? You know, what does it look like? When will we be talking about the fifth grade moving? Can we accommodate for family choice for the children who are at South, families might have children both at South and at Hollis at the same time in the transition period? And I'm just going to answer that question now and tell you, yes, we can do that. That certainly is something that we can accommodate for, and we believe it is best offered by choice. So families can choose that option if they want to. How can we continue the question was, can we continue grade five enrichment and traditions that we've done? PTO is one example of that. That question came up at the last meeting. And I've continued to say that really falls on parents. It would be part of the planning process. We believe in certainly in parent involvement and would want to make sure that we provide those opportunities, continue to provide those opportunities. What about after school options? Some have asked the question, you know, what happens after school? My child's going to get out at a different time. Would there be some opportunities for that? Again, I think that's part of the planning process and doable for us. And then transportation considerations, certainly something we need to continue to look at or really begin to look at in earnest if this proposal were to go through. So the timeline, just to be really clear, grade five would not move to east or to south until the construction project was completed. So we're not talking about bringing grade five until the construction work is done. The site is no longer out of construction. At that point, we would look to bring the grade five to both east and south. The timing on these are a little bit different. The timeline for east is a little bit more clear because it's an MSBA approved project. Their timelines are pretty well defined. We do need by the 10th next week to notify them if we are committed to a project expansion, which is why we're kind of in the time frame that we're in. This was an expansion of the renovation project. They allowed us to go and ask for additional funding to add space to the building at East here without going back through the entire application process, which is not something that they normally allow, but they believe that this is a good solution for Braintree. On the 23rd, the town council is going to consider the mayor's recommendation for a feasibility study to the tune of about $250,000. And then you can see the remaining pieces of that with the idea that we would be trying to do occupancy for grades 5 through 8 at East in 2019. So the 19-20 school year would be the target. Now, obviously, these are all tentative. These are all subject to change. There's a lot that would have to happen between now and then. South is a little different. We would put in for a statement of interest, an SOI, to the MSBA, which is the building authority that makes determinations about whether or not the state is going to provide funding. That SOI would include an expansion of South to accommodate for grade five from two schools. We'd conduct a feasibility study in the summer. And then at that point, we'd have to kind of figure out what we're going to do next, because if the MSBA comes back and says, yes, we will support this, we'll provide some funding, that process and that timeline is theirs. They own it. We're subject to it. If they say no, then we'll have to explore funding options. If we have to fund this locally, then obviously there's a lot of considerations that need to be made. But at the same time, the timeline is a little bit more flexible because it's our determination as to what the process is going to look like. And then again, you can see it's all really dependent on what happens in terms of the timeline. But there are several points in this, I want to be clear, that will be inclusive in terms of building design, programmatic design, some of the questions I think that have come up about logistics of after-school programming, some of those kinds of pieces would be inclusive and would be open, and parents could be part of that planning process. We would want parents to be part of that planning process as well as teachers and administrators. So, just real quickly to look at the enrollment analysis. So one of the biggest, NESDEC is the company that most school systems will contract with to do enrollment projections. This particular slide shows what NESDEC, and this is a recent projection, what NESDEC was recommending or projecting for our enrollment to look like over the next several years. I think what's important to note about this is if you look at the K through 5 column, so it's three columns over K through 5, our current enrollment right now, this would have been as of October 1, was 2,495 students K through 5. If you follow that projection down, the highest point or the peak projection in this particular outlook was 2,702 students in the year 2023-24. So even with a projection that has actually, and I'll show you in a second, has proven not necessarily to be reliable after you get past 4 or 5 years, they are projecting that the highest enrollment we will experience in K through 5 will be about 207 students more than we currently have. Now, for us right now, given our classroom space issues, we would definitely field 207 students. And I can almost guarantee you that all of them would show up to Liberty for some reason, and it'd all be in one grade level. which is another issue which I'll show on the next slide. So if you look at the last couple of years, 14 and the current year we're in 15, I think that the biggest challenge we face, not only are we experiencing some moderate growth, and I would describe this as moderate growth. I don't think this is explosion of growth. And if you look at the past enrollment, while we have seen steady growth over the last 10 years, we're not out of control with growth. The biggest issue we have is where the growth ends up showing up. And if you just kind of take a look at this, is a breakdown by school. And if you can, you can do kind of the toggling with your eyes between 14 and 15, but you'll see that it's not always consistent and it's not always certainly not equal. You'll see, for example, Ross in 2014 went from 267 to 304. Morrison, though, went from 400 to, I believe that's 383. So there's a lot of fluctuation and there's a lot of fluidity in where kids are showing, where families are showing up, which makes a lot of sense. I think if you think about where's the new housing, where are the opportunities for families to move into town, generally they are kind of in that Highlands, Liberty, Morrison catchment area, and not so much at some of the other schools. So it makes it difficult when you're already stretched on space at a particular school, and the district has been very consistent with not redistricting. They have let children go to where they land in the district that they're in. But it makes it really puts a lot of crunch on. I think that uneven distribution is a larger problem even than the enrollment increase. So next slide. This just kind of shows you, how these projections work. Again, these are the NESDEC numbers. These are the numbers that Habib used in their study. And if you just look at, in 2010, so projected 2010, the second column from the left, in 11 and 12, you'll see that the projection that was done in the fall of 2010 projected that in 11-12 there were going to be 2,525 students K through 5. If you follow the row all the way over to the right and you see the actual, you'll see the actual enrollment 1 year removed from the projection was 2,489. Now, that's pretty common. It's not bad statistically. It's kind of the plus or minus. But at the same time, when space is already a challenge, that those numbers mean something. That differential, we can feel it, especially, again, depending on where those numbers are landing. And if you just look at 2010, you follow it all the way down to 15-16, you'll see that, in 2010, they projected us to have 2,647 students. Our current K through 5 enrollment, or as of October 1st, was 2,495. So I'm only making this point to show you that everyone's been talking a lot about projections. There have been multiple projection studies done. It's part of the MSBA project. You have to do it, and there are good people doing it. It's a very much a statistical process, and different companies look at it differently. Most will put most of the weight on how many children were born 5 years ago and how many of them showed up in kindergarten when they were 5 years old. And then they call it a cohort survival. So of the kids who were born, how many stayed in town and actually enrolled in kindergarten? So when they were doing these projections, and I think we all know, the challenge isn't as much about how many children were born in Braintree. It's about how many children are moving in. They've already been born. They were born somewhere else, and the families move into town. So it's not an exact science. We have some challenges in these predictions for any company coming in to look at that because we have multifamily units. Move-ins really are kind of the challenge we face. And, there certainly are reliability problems beyond 4 and 5 years. So you wouldn't want to look at these numbers 10 years from now and say that's we can bank on that number in a 10-year projection. It just has proven, and the companies will admit, that once you get past 4 or 5 years, the reliability of the data start to drop. So just taking a look at the next slide, and then one more. God. Give you just one job, really. we can switch if you want. you know, when in just looking at our facilities and trying to get us a lot of the conversation on my arrival was really K-5 with a BEAV study. A lot of conversation around the middle school, obviously East was in the pipeline. But I think all of us understand, too, this is a K-12 issue. And I think trying to come up with a recommendation that tries to offer a K-12 solution was really my goal. I didn't want to come to the committee with something that wouldn't try to address, I think, what I believe to be all of the issues that we face as a school department and trying to come up with a reasonable plan for that. So the good news is this. All our buildings are structurally sound. You know, there are school systems, and I know you don't believe this because I've talked to many of you, who have schools that are crumbling. They have structural issues. Someone, I think Representative Cusack, shared with me there's a school within his district that they actually have a handrail in one of the classrooms because the floor slants so badly that they have to have a handrail in order to make sure people don't get hurt. All right? We don't have that. We have space issues. We certainly have classrooms that could be freshened. We certainly have spaces that are being used as classrooms or instructional spaces that were never designed to be that. But our buildings are structurally sound. You know, so when the MSBA comes in and they look at our requests, that's one of the biggest factors for them is, are your buildings structurally sound? And if they're not, you have a higher priority. And on top of that, are you hanging portable units off your schools? So do you have, you know, 10% or 15% of your population out in a portable unit in a trailer, essentially behind the school somewhere on the side of the school because there's not enough space within the buildings? And that's not our case. So when we apply for these projects, or where you've applied for these projects in the past, the rating is, it's hard for us to do really, really well in the rating for those reasons. We certainly have maximized our available space. I mean, Hollis would be, I think, the only school right now that you could say reasonably has some additional room. And I would not describe that as a whole lot of room. But I think that they have enough flexibility where if they have some movement in their enrollment, they can make adjustments within the school. That's not true, really, for any of our other schools, including our middle schools. It's certainly true for our high school. Our class sizes here are unbelievably favorable. We are very fortunate. You are very fortunate as parents that you've had a school system, a school committee, previous superintendents, a mayor, a town council that supports the notion that small class sizes make a difference for teaching and learning. And I'll tell you, I've done a lot of looks at a lot of different places about in terms of school size, classroom size. Our classroom sizes, the number of students in front of each one of our teachers, is very favorable. And that is certainly a priority. It's a core value. But our classrooms aren't overcrowded. So it's not a matter of that we have small classrooms and the classrooms feel small to kids. That's really not the issue. As much as it is that we are now facing, and I think over the several years, trying to provide programs for students with special needs that require specialized spaces. We're trying to make sure we maintain small class sizes, which means that we need those classrooms for more teachers to make sure that we don't have class sizes that start to go up as a result of not having enough classroom space. And again, you know, you do have, certainly we have the enrollment-driven issues due mainly to movement. So then when we just take a look at Braintree High School, I mean, you know, Braintree High School is structurally sound, and the square footage that we enjoy at that high school, albeit awkward in some places. I made the mistake of going to the basement, and it took me an hour to find my way out of the basement. If you've never had a chance to go to the basement in Braintree High School, it's quite an experience. It's structurally sound, huge square footage. If we requested and were approved, which I'll tell you the MSBA is highly unlikely to approve a new high school for Braintree, because why? Building's structurally sound, you're not hanging portable units off it. They're not going to participate in what would probably be $150 to $165 million facility. And that's what new high schools are going for. And you don't have to look very far to see brand new high schools that have been built at those price tags. They're probably not going to see that as a high need in the collection of applications that they get from the 300-plus school systems across the Commonwealth. The campus setting couldn't be better. I mean, that, in my view, everything is there. The facilities are there. We're not busing kids to practice fields. You know, we're not having to deal with any of those kinds of space crunches. There's plenty of land there. It's in the middle of town, which gives you huge advantages in terms of transportation costs. And finally, you know, it's in need of renovation. I mean, I don't think there's anyone who can say that high school couldn't benefit from some money into new science labs, technology, reconfiguration of some spaces, rethinking how we, you know, use the media center as an example. That media center is huge space. You know, is that where we are with library media and technology today, or should we rethink some of those kinds of spaces to better match the educational programming that we're doing? So this recommendation does include consideration of some work at the high school. You know, the other thing I think is important in just looking at the last few years and looking at the amount of money that's been put into renovations here, while none of them necessarily solved the space issue, many of them solved many of the other issues that our buildings face as a result of their age. I mean, certainly just fresh off the top of my mind is the infrastructure technology upgrade. You know, we've had over $1 million put into technology. We have all brand new cabling across our buildings. We have wireless access. And while we're still bringing that online, you know, it's pretty amazing that we have schools who have that kind of backbone from a technology standpoint. We've had green repairs, you know, at the middle school, South Middle School. Five schools actually were down, core program at South. And we've had multiple projects, smaller projects that add up to a lot of money in total to around $17 million over the last several years. So just kind of recapping the Habib study. So Habib was brought in by the town. MSBA did not ask Habib to come in. The town was trying to be proactive, commissioned a study to say, can you please look at our facilities, look at our enrollment, and provide us some options that we can look at and consider and have a conversation around. They did so in 2012. They came up with five options and multiple subsets of each one of those options. They only recommended certain of those options. So even though they came up with five, they would go through and say, you know, we don't recommend, I'll show you what they recommended, but they recommended only a few of each one of those within the five. All the options, they all focused on elementary. There was not a study that looked at the middle school or the high school. They used the NASDAQ projections that I just showed you earlier. And then, you know, you can kind of see that the cost ranged anywhere from $21 to $123 million on the options that they proposed to deal with the K through 5 buildings. So these are the options that came out of the study that were recommended. Option one was to open Eldridge, Foster, and Mattaquette, which obviously we've already done with Mattaquette. The option recommended upgrades to all schools. So those three facilities plus all the other six elementaries were to receive upgrades, facilities upgrades. In addition, the elementary schools were also going to get additions, so actual new space. The price tag on that 2012 recommendation was a little over $65 million, $65.5 million. Option 2B was to create additions to create six equal elementary schools. So that would mean that all the six that exist would not have the kindergarten center. They'd all have K through 5. They would all be added to create six equal schools. So if they had to in this scenario, there would have been redistricting from Liberty to Morrison or Morrison to Highlands or however it would have worked out. This option would have forced redistricting. The price tag on this was almost $71 million. And I think, you know, to bring you back to the earlier conversation about enrollment and where students are showing up, the challenge is they don't show up equally. So to say we're going to create, you know, six equal elementary schools, I think this option, had it been enacted, would have probably required fairly regular redistricting to balance off the numbers. Option 3B had different size additions to each elementary school to try to deal with both the existing population and projected, although it's very tough to project to an individual school, and there would be no redistricting. The idea, we're going to add on everyone, we're not going to redistrict, and that price tag was about $67 million. And option 4B, build a seventh elementary school, additions to all the remaining elementary schools, and then you would have to redistrict because who's going to the new elementary school? Where is it going to be? You know, those kind of questions. That was about $81 million. And finally, you know, and I don't know if this was ever an option that was seriously considered, but I think they were just trying to show the range of options would be to build four brand new elementary schools with a 10-year phase-in, These would be about 87,000 square foot buildings on 15-acre sites. And those would have required, obviously, redistricting. So you would have taken the existing elementary schools and essentially walked away from them at the time when this was concluded. Okay? So those were the options that Habib presented. So solutions, or my recommendation to the committee in terms of where we are right now and what I think is the best solution. So just to kind of let you know how I felt, what I felt I was, we were all working within. I think we need a solution in a 3 to 5 year window. Okay, I don't think professionally, in looking at all the data and coming in here and looking at your schools and seeing some of the things that are happening instructionally and what's getting taught in hallways and who's has what closet for not, I don't think we have a, I don't think we have an 8 to 12 year timeline. I think we need to find a solution that addresses the students we have in front of us and provides the best opportunities we can for the students who are going to be coming down the road. If we were going to go down the path of 6 elementary schools applying to MSBA to try to get funding, one, it's certainly not guaranteed, and I think we experienced that because Liberty was just recently declined, and while there has been some comments around why that might be true, the fact of the matter is MSBA is likely not going to fund more than one project at a time in a school system our size. They're looking for a longer-term solution. So let's just assume for a second that we were able to turn an application around every 2 or 3 years. Let's assume those were successful and we had MSBA participation. We're still looking at a window of 12 years or so before we're in a place where we've gotten that taken care of. Future elementary submissions face tough competition. I think, you know, what we're hearing is that big city school systems, Worcester, Boston, are in line to put projects in, and the competition is only going to get tougher through the MSBA. And they, again, you know, where this kind of came down to is when we started saying, well, can we ask you to consider, would you be willing to consider looking at the East Project differently for us if we're also trying to solve a long-term issue? I think that they want to support good long-term solutions. And I think that they were open to this because I think they do believe, I know they believe, that this is a project that could really substantially help us in the long term with our elementary space challenges. So we'd be ready to go to another slide. Thank you. Okay. So my recommendation is to expand the scope of the approved East Middle School project to include grades 5 through 8. My recommendation would be for this building, to accommodate Flaherty, Hollis, Morrison, and Ross, which represents about 60% of our population. I have several reasons why I believe that's the right combination, including the fact that there's just better green space and availability at this site than there are at South. I would make a recommendation for a similar expansion to South to accommodate Highlands and Liberty. It wouldn't be as many classrooms. Grade 5 would be designed to be a school within a school. So we have programmatically, essentially, we would have a self-contained or the ability to continue with a self-contained grade 5 team. As you know, of those of you who have grade 5 children or have had grade 5 children, many already rotate for content area within a team. We would maintain that as part of the planning and design process. And then we would also address existing space challenges at both East and South, including accessibility and programmatic design and flow of the building itself. So I think the best example for me right now in this building in East is that, you know, you have all the core classroom spaces. The media center is on that side of the building. You know, generally, if you're designing from scratch, your library media center, you kind of want more central and more core to your classrooms, to your building, because it's the heart of the building. So I think it gives us an opportunity through the design process to kind of rethink how our building works for our kids and for our teachers and try to take care of some of those issues at the same time. So moving grade 5, and this is just based on the current classrooms by school that we currently use for grade 5 students. Moving grade 5 to the middle schools would allow us to, or would make available, 22 classrooms across the school system. It was 21, Ms. McDonald pointed out that I missed one at Hollis in my counting, so that's you see the adjustment made for tonight. So there are five at Hollis for a total of 22 classrooms. In addition to the classroom spaces, or because of the classroom spaces being freed up, we would be in a position, given our current population, that we would be able to have separate spaces, programmatic spaces, for programs like art and music, for library media technology, for small group instruction. So we might take one classroom that's been freed up and actually separate that room, that space, up into a couple of classrooms or a couple smaller group instructional spaces. But it gives us the flexibility to provide those programs in their own dedicated spaces, on top of the fact that we'll have enough classrooms for students in the general classroom. We would look to provide additions to both Flaherty and Ross that would essentially construct a new gymnasium. More than likely, it would be a gymnasium to separate the gym and cafeteria spaces that currently exist. Big smiles up front from Mrs. Soto. We would explore options for accelerating renovations at all schools. And one of the points that I made the other night, and I think it's really a very important point, is that, not just because I said it, but I do think it's an important point, if we're able to do the renovations at the high school, we're able to do the renovations at East, and we're able to do the renovations at South, the $1 million a year that the mayor and council have been providing in terms of renovations or capital projects can really start to focus more just on the elementary level. And I do think there's some other opportunities for us to look at how we might be able to provide more funding for additional renovations at the elementary level, new boiler upgrades, those kinds of things. And we would also look to, and I think this is a really important conversation, to provide some kind of policy control for new families moving into town and where they're moving. So I think we have to regain some control of where our kids go to school. Existing population, leave alone, not talking about redistricting people that are currently here, but as we think about the future and plan out ahead, we know that we're probably going to have more families that are going to move into Liberty Highlands area. I think we need to think about, are there places where we have buses that are running to more than one school? And do we create some flexible boundaries in zoning so that when a new family comes in, they're told, you're going to be placed in either Liberty or Highlands as an example. And then we make that decision based on what our numbers look like, based on the class enrollment, so that we can better control across the board long term for what has been, I think, uncontrollable from the standpoint of where families are moving into town. So at East, we would put in for a statement of interest. That would happen in April. We'd look to, I'm talking about South. Let me go back to East. East is already in the pipeline. We'd be looking to add 12 to 15 additional classrooms. Some of those spaces might not be straight classrooms. They might be some kind of different educational space. We would be looking to continue with the upgrade that was already planned as part of that project. And we'd also take a look at our programmatic and core spaces and whether or not we could do some upgrades there as well as part of the project. We would submit for a statement of interest to the MSBA for South in April 2016. And then generally the process is that you submit for an SOI, you find out you get approved, then you do a feasibility study. My recommendation is that we submit for the SOI, we go ahead and do the feasibility study anyway so that we have that information about what we would be looking to do at South. And then if the funding comes through from MSBA, that's a piece of work that we have done. If it doesn't come through, then we got to figure out what we're going to do locally. But we have the information and we can plan around it. Braintree High School, I would recommend a solid, extensive renovation project. I think really doing a feasibility study in the fall of 2016, coming in and really looking at the spaces, talking to parents, talking to educators, talking to architects, people who understand what that space could be. It was designed for around 3,400 students. We have around 1,600 now. We've got plenty of space. I think it gives us a lot of opportunity to think differently about the space we have and how we use it. I would recommend that we submit for a statement of interest to the MSBA for consideration of renovation to Braintree High School in January 2017. Feasibility study would already be done. We'd find out from MSBA whether they would be willing to partner with us on that or not, and then we'd go from there. And again, I've already pointed out from my perspective what I think, why it's huge advantages to looking at a renovation of the high school as opposed to construction of a new building. So some of the costs of this are obviously they're all tentative, they're all up in the air, but I think it's important just to kind of give you an estimate or give you estimates on what we think we know at this point. Very rough numbers, subject to change. At the elementary level, Flaherty Gym Cafeteria, Ross Gym Cafeteria, probably about $2 million a piece. We would continue with the capital projects money that we've been receiving, hopefully, from the mayor, from the town, to continue to work on the elementary level. Then that is all local costs. There's no town state share on that. The East Middle School project looks like a price range between $20 and $35 million, depending on how the projections come in and the cost estimates. The actual state share of this project, because we're now asking for additional space, has gone from what would have been 50.58% for straight renovation to, it puts us in a little bit of a different reimbursement category, potentially as high as 58%. And that's not firm, but that is a range. We should fall somewhere within that range. So, out of a $28 to $35 million project, we'd be receiving roughly half or a little bit better back. South Addition renovation, we'd be looking probably in the neighborhood of $9 to $12 million. We'd put in the SOI, find out whether MSBA would be able to support and us with that. And then at that point, we'd know whether that would be any of that would be shared by the state or whether it would all fall on us locally. And then finally, the high school renovation, we'd do a feasibility study in the fall. And then, those numbers would start to fall into place depending on the scope of the work. So I'm a father, I'm a superintendent. I wouldn't be in front of this committee, in front of this group, in front of any of you if I didn't believe that this option is not just good from a financial standpoint, from a feasibility, from a pragmatic standpoint to address the issues we have and we know we have currently. It is, I think, the straightest line between A and B for us right now. It's an opportunity that we can take advantage of that did not exist a couple months ago. I believe that this programmatically does really good things for fifth grade kids. And I know that there's, I've heard some parents talk about some trepidation around that. My experience as a principal was straight K through 8. I saw K through 8, what that looks like, how it comes together as a community, how older kids take care of younger kids. Some of the things we experience certainly at the elementary level now with fifth graders in the building with kindergarten, I understand that. But from a programmatic standpoint, I think we have an opportunity to open up some additional options for grade 5 that don't currently exist that are part of the middle-level program, such as foreign language. I think guidance services start to look different. Health education starts to look different. I think it provides better consistency from a curriculum standpoint when you've got grade 5 here, the teachers are here, they're talking about what their curriculum and instruction looks like instead of at 6 different locations. I think there's a huge advantage to that, especially at fifth grade when we start to talk about really kind of accelerated pathways for students as they prepare to go into middle school and the high school to take advantage of courses that are AP as an example. More time spent at the middle school level I think is a good thing. So educators get to know families better. You've got 4 years instead of 3. And again, I think we can do this. I know we can do this within a self-contained environment if that's what we choose to do. I think we have an opportunity to deliver better services more efficiently to students with special needs, English, ELL students. Currently, we face challenges because, like the rest of the population, ELL students move in different locations. We need to provide services for those students, but in some places we only have a few, some places we have more, and trying to kind of bring more students together helps to be more efficient with that kind of thing. And I also think we have an opportunity to open up and allow participation in after-school activities for grade 5. So that's the final slide. I've really kind of taken you already through the timeline. That timeline is really specific to East. And again, I think from this point forward, if all goes well, regardless of what the project ends up looking like, we would be looking for a completion date in September of 2019. The other thing I would just add is I think that it's one of the things we would look to do is leverage the new space construction here at East to have as swing space, technically. So build the new space first if we can, the new classrooms first, empty one of our existing wings into the new space, renovate that existing wing, switch back out and just go through that process. I think it helps us to accelerate and better manage the process and the timeline. So With that, Madam Chair.
Dr. Hackett, for the presentation again. At this time, I'm going to open up to Councillor.
Thank you, Chairwoman Keeger. Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Hackett, for the presentation. I just want to add a little bit more history of what the School Building Committee had done in the past in terms of the statement of interest. Back in 2007, we submitted a statement of interest to the MSBA that included all 9 schools, and South was the priority. So we basically asked them to partner with us on renovations for all the schools, but said South was our first priority, the first one we'd like them to look at. It wasn't until they eventually, after that, approved South, and in 2010, we completed the renovations of $3.2 million at South. MSBA did partner with us on that project. From that point on, we continue to submit statement of interest. We have one shot every year to submit a statement of interest. In 2011, it was the first year that we submitted East. We again submitted all 9 schools. Eight, because South was done. We submitted all 8 schools to MSBA. East was now the priority because we worked on South. When we finished South, we said we're going to be working on East. So each year from 2011, we submitted this to MSBA, and each year, for whatever reason, they didn't approve it. So we as a committee decided MSBA was going to share 50% of the cost of the total project with us. So we as a committee thought it's the best interest of the town. Why would you leave 50% of these multi-million dollar projects on the table? So we waited because we wanted to partner with MSBA. So from 2011 until last year, we kept submitting East, and East was finally approved. So we didn't just come to the table with this East project last year. It's been ongoing since 2007. And it is a process because, again, we're waiting for the approval from MSBA, and we think that is in the best interest of the entire town to do that. And I've always felt the brand new buildings don't make for the best schools. It's our principals, our directors, our administration, the quality of the teachers and the curriculum that makes Braintree one of the best schools in the state of Massachusetts. Our students continually outscore students across the state, the nation, and other countries on all standardized testing. So I don't think there's anybody in this room that will argue that our schools need some updating. Yes, they do. But just wanted to give you a little background of where we've been and how we got here tonight. So thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Hume. I'd also like to recognize Councilor Mike Owens, who's also joined us as well. So thank you. At this time, I'm going to open it up to all of you. Again, thank you all for coming. I do ask, we have 2 mics. Did you come up to the mic? You state your name, you make your statement, ask your question. I ask that you limit your statement, if you could, just in the interest of time. And with that, anybody like to come up and start us off? I'd also like to recognize Councilor Kokoris. Chuck Kokoris also joined us as well. Hi, if you could state your name, please.
Hi, I'm Libby Costello. I have 3 girls in the Braintree school system. I think the presentation's great, and I'm excited to learn more about what the program is going to entail with 5th graders being moved to middle school. I think if the kindergarten center is any indication, it's going to be an excellent, excellent program. My concern is the redistricting of all of Hollis to East. Currently, our home is district for Hollis and South. I know you spoke to that a little bit about parents having a choice. I'd want some more information on that. I did have a petition that I started to speak to the redistricting. Currently, there are 137 families or residents on that petition that oppose redistricting. So I'd just like some more information on what the choice would be, who would be eligible for it, what the transportation options would be, that kind of information.
Dr. Hackett, could I
So just specifically, I don't know if this is on, but specifically to, yeah, I think there's a period of time when there's going to be a transition for certain families. Certain families are going to have a period where they may have a student who is already at one middle school, and then they may be at South already. And then they have another middle schooler coming in who might be at East as a result of the project. So, you know, obviously we would not want to split families in that way, and we would want to make sure families who are in that situation would have the choice as to whether or not they would want to have their children go to one or the other or remain split. You know, there's a window of when that would be true, and I think we can certainly accommodate that. Beyond that discussion, there really hasn't been more of a discussion. I think that, you know, clearly part of the hope is to leverage the MSBA funding. We know that more kids means we wouldn't be talking about an addition to East if we weren't talking about bringing more kids to the campus. So, and the campus lends itself, I think, to have a larger school. With the exception of half of Hollis right now, the schools that we're talking about already feed into East. So it's really, other than the half that doesn't, it really isn't a change for where the schools currently feed their sixth grade. So, you know, with that, that's the best answer I can give you right now in and around that.
My name is Linda Wells. I teach first grade at Liberty School. I'm also the parent of three grown children who all graduated from Braintree High School, who all went to Liberty School. I'm also the daughter of retired Braintree Elementary teacher and principal, and the daughter-in-law of a retired Braintree principal for many years. I have a loving and long connection with Braintree without growing up here myself. I have lived through redistricting and the closing of schools and the reopening of schools. I appreciate, Dr. Hackett, your comment about the 3 to 5 year window and how important it is that we really start to address these needs for our students and families. I am heartened that we're thinking ahead and planning for the number of students and families that we have in Braintree. Although the current plan involving the middle school sounds like it addresses the need, I still believe it does not address the long overdue needs of our current elementary schools, although I did see in your presentation a real effort to do that. So I commend you for that. At Liberty, if I could just give you an idea of what our students are dealing with and our staff and families are dealing with. We have a library or computer center in our cafeteria, and I wonder if any of you have tried to use your workspace or workplace as a cafeteria as well. We have special educators meeting with students in hallways, our children who are at risk, meeting in hallways with their teachers. And I ask you if any of you would meet with clients or your work partners in hallways to work. Some of our teachers are even needing to use our teachers' room as a space just so that it has less distraction. We have our special educators meeting with students in spaces no larger than the restroom at our school. Some spaces do not have ventilation or windows. There is no professional space to meet with parents. I know we as teachers think of ourselves as professionals, and yet when we bring a family in to meet, we're often sitting at a small table in a room without any windows, where if somebody comes in or leaves the room, everybody has to stand and sort of readjust. And we all make this work because that's what we do. It's about the students that we serve, but it doesn't make it right. We have other specialists who are sharing small spaces, no bigger than the restroom if you use the restroom here. We have specialists that are sharing a space that size. Many of those smaller spaces are not even soundproof, so if our school psychologist is meeting with families or talking to parents, those conversations can be heard on the other side of the wall. We have tiles and ceilings that are peeling. Our rugs are moldy. We have one room that has been repeatedly flooded because of broken pipes. We have temperatures in our classrooms that vary from 52 degrees to 96 degrees. We do not have speakers in our hallway or bathrooms or special ed spaces. And in case of an emergency, it is a real concern of our faculty that we make sure that our children are safe. It is 2016, and we do not have appropriate spaces for art and music and the lessons that we provide for our students, our OT or PT. Our classrooms in this age of technology that we have so promoted within our system, and yet our classrooms have two plugs, two in the whole classroom. Our students, our staff, and our families deserve much better facilities. And I appreciate all that's being done in terms of making space available for our fifth grade. But these are buildings that, although they may be structurally sound, there are so many issues that should be addressed immediately. As you've said, Ms. Hume, I know you said how well our students are doing and our testing and shows how well we're doing. Then our buildings should reflect that level of excellence. I appreciate your time, and I invite any of you to come and visit and come and see our classrooms and see where people are and see our library and see how hard that our staff is working to make these spaces work. And as someone who's had children come through this school, I can tell you these are issues that have gone on for many, many years. I had children that had a room for music, and it was taken away. We've had a space for the library, and it was taken away. There should be space. It should be a priority that our schools have designated spaces for our students. So I thank you very much for your time.
So I just want to express my appreciation, as all of you just did, for the comments. I think that, you know, liberty is particularly a difficult challenge. I know that there isn't anyone sitting up front here who doesn't recognize that liberty really is, in some ways, the challenge. I think that there's a lot of reasons why that's true. I think that there's been a real effort in the school system to not redistrict students. I think there's been a real effort in the school system to provide small class sizes, and I think there's been a real effort, commendable effort in the school system to make sure we're serving all populations of students, regardless of what their needs are. The fact of the matter is, we're out of space everywhere. Liberty, we're feeling it particularly, and I do believe, with all due respect, that the recommendation that I've given this group and that the school committee will be looking at again next week solves so many of those issues in such a short period of time. I have seen the plans in terms of looking at Liberty. I'll be honest with you, when I go to Liberty, when I go through and I see all the things that you mentioned, I don't believe that site can hold more kids. I don't believe the site can hold the number of kids that we currently have. I mean, all you have to do is show up at the end of the day to watch the dismissal process, to watch cars queued up, to watch buses come in, to realize something's not right. It is really congested, and it's just a function of where it's located. That school needs fewer students, and there are only certain ways you can get to that solution. Adding additional classroom space onto Liberty, to me, is not a good decision. It's not the right choice. I think we got to find better choices than that. I think this represents a better choice than that. And I think controlling for the population long term is a better choice than that. And I certainly recognize and believe that if we can take care of some of these issues immediately, more immediately, with the MSBA support, that we also have additional resources to deal with some of the other issues that we're experiencing in all of our schools or some of our schools in terms of the actual facility. So I I do recognize and appreciate the comments. I also know that I've had similar conversations with many of you. So I think you are fully aware, and I do think we're looking for a solution. So thank you.
Center and one is at Hollis. You were also at Ross. When I listened to your presentation, you had an external company come in 2012 to do all these studies, but it's 4 years later. And then all the recommendations that they made, we're not even moving with those. So I'm wondering if we're moving too fast as a town and not stepping back and getting another external recommendation. Is it appropriate to move fifth to middle school, or is it appropriate to do something like Weymouth does, move fifth and sixth to one, or seven and eighth to another? I just think we're trying to move fast, get the money that we don't want to leave on the table, but are we doing the right thing for all schools and all kids? And I know you don't have an answer, but I think it's just a recommendation. Maybe we're moving a little too fast here.
Well, he presented it, and you have 1 week to make a decision.
I'm wearing a couple hats right now. I'm a sixth grade teacher in a neighboring town, and I'm also a parent or a future parent. My daughter's 9 months old, and I'm here because I'm so concerned. I've substitute taught in this town. I did my student teaching in this building 6 years ago. My sister was a teacher at Morrison until she stayed at home with her kids. I know the teachers in this district are amazing and incredible and will go above and beyond for the children. And they are right now because they're at their max. It seems this is my first meeting because I didn't realize that this was happening so quickly and things were moving. This is the first meeting I'm attending, and I plan on attending future ones. But it seems like the issue is an elementary school issue, and I work in Hingham, and they just went through the MSBA kind of helping make that middle school. I think we should take that money because it makes sense. Like you said, don't leave it on the table, but if that money is going to, make renovations on the middle school and the elementary schools, do that. But then there needs to be a long-term resolution for these elementary schools. You can just look in your neighborhoods. Don't use these projections. Three houses flipped in my neighborhood, and they all have children, newborns. The prices in this town are out of this world because people are moving here for these schools. People are planning to raise their children in these great schools. We need to invest. That's why our property values are going up, because of the school system. So I don't understand why we're not investing in these elementary schools, making them better and planning for the future. That's what I feel like Braintree has right now, is the school system. Personally, as a teacher, when moving the fifth grade to the sixth grade or to the middle school, I don't know what you realize what you're doing to those teachers. That's pretty isolating. They, their career, their education was focused on elementary style teaching. That's where they belong. That's where they feel comfortable. Taking them from the elementary school, and dumping them here with great teachers, like I said, but that's their home. And if teachers aren't happy, it's going to, trickle down into the children. Fifth graders are developmentally not ready to be at the middle school. I teach sixth grade. Some of the sixth graders I have are too little to be in sixth grade already. What I worry about is having my fifth grader on the bus or in the cafeteria with eighth graders, my fifth graders being with eighth graders. That's the least supervised, places. Even though the teachers are amazing and they do a great job, they're just sixth, seventh, and eighth graders are going through so many physical, emotional, mental, changes that the fifth graders are not aware of, and they should be kept in the dark about those things. And I just would like the fifth graders to stay at the elementary schools and solve the real problem that our money and our focus seems to be on these elementary schools, which my sister worked in. I've seen it. It was awful. I don't know. Thank you.
Here tonight, and this has been a part of our discussion in terms of all those other pieces, beyond the facilities. What about the educational program? What about the appropriateness of fifth graders being in a middle school? I can tell you there are several communities that have 5-8 middle schools. This is not something that has never been done before. I shared my experience as a K-8 principal, and I know programmatically and from a space standpoint and a building design standpoint that you can make a lot of choices about how you set your building up to make sure you are protecting the values that you want in and around your program for kids. So if that's a fifth grade self-contained school within a school, that's very doable. You know, the suggestions around, I completely, and I said this to a parent today, you know, if money were no option, and if all the options were available, and we didn't have this in front of us right now, you know, I'm sure that there might be some other considerations. I think the question is, what is the best, don't let perfection be the enemy of good? What is the best solution that solves our issues, short and long term, that we can enact upon and do soon? So, thanks. I don't think that was as many applause as the last speaker. So if we could do that, no, I'm sorry. If we could, I would like a couple of principles. I don't know, I know Donna Bonarigo, who's on the building committee, has been close to this discussion, and certainly if any other principals, you know, want to step in, just, I think maybe just kind of talk about the fifth grade piece, if you would.
Fifth grade, and as a former fifth grade teacher for 8 years, and principal of our school for now my 9th year, it is a big change, but I do feel that fifth graders are more than ready in many ways to be at a middle school. And there are towns surrounding us who have moved to this model. I was just talking today with a teacher at my school who lives in Hanover, who and that's a district that has for many years had 5-8 schools, and successfully, and even now apparently Hanover is looking at either building a school or doing some changes to their buildings. And what is not on the table is moving fifth grade back to elementary, because they have seen that to be so successful. I think the plan that Dr. Hackett has put forward is one that's very sensitive to the needs of fifth graders in the sense of the school within a school. I know some other towns have gone to a 2- or 3-year range within their schools. As a parent, my kids went to schools that were 2 or 3 years, and then they moved on. It was a lot of transitioning. As a parent, I felt that, you know, my children never really got connected with the schools before it was time to move on, that they weren't, the teachers there didn't get to know them as well as I and the teachers at Ross have been able to get to know kids with the age span. And I think kids moving to fifth grade as part of a middle school, they're there for 4 years, and that gives the middle school teachers and administrators a good opportunity to get to know them before it's time for them to move on to the high school. So, you know, I feel, as Dr. Hackett said, we don't want the perfect to be the enemy of the good. I would not want my fifth graders to move, because I love having them, but I feel very confident that they will be happy and successful at our middle school. So I do feel, in terms of having a plan that's viable quickly, this is the plan to go with.
My name is Karen Kelleher, and first of all, I want to welcome you, Dr. Hackett. Welcome to Braintree.
It's awesome.
Yeah. No, really, though, leading that, thank you for taking this on. I'm sure it hasn't been simple. Yeah, and thank all of you for your hard work. I know it also has not been a simple process, and I don't think any of us understand all the funding and the complications at all. Fifth grade moving to the middle school is okay with me. It probably would be more difficult if I didn't have two who already have gone through, and I might be putting my house on the market thinking, oh my goodness. But having had that experience, I do think fifth graders are okay, and I trust that the model will be appropriate. My concern lies in the inequality of the sizes of the schools, and to purposely be taking four schools, feeding them into one, and two schools into another, it creates a bit of an inequality and a disadvantage. Not only the size, and only knowing 25% of the students opposed to 50 going in and the adjustment, but once you're there, you know, academics is important, but so is being a part of it. You know, the soccer team, the basketball team, the play. What are you going to do? You can't accommodate, you know, you're going to have two soccer teams? Look at the plays. They are busting. And those directors take everyone. I don't know how they do it. But at some point, you know, if it gets too big, are they going to have to say no? So I think if there's a way to make it more equal, you know, I'm partial to South just because that's where my two have gone and they have thrived. I'm sure East is excellent. And if we got redistricted and it were three schools and three schools, I would be okay with that. But the four and the two just seems like a pretty big disadvantage. So I just ask you to think about that and consider if there's a way to make it more equal. Because 10 years down the road, I wonder if people will say, why do we have so many go into one and so little go into one? And I just think there are even more issues with it than I'm even thinking of at the moment. But I just ask that you think about that and see if there's a way to even it out now before the buildings are constructed and funding and what other complicated issues go into it. Thank you.
How you doing, everybody? I'm glad you had this forum. My name is Mark Moore. I live on Howie Road. I have three children. I have a fourth grader, a second grader at Stacy Soto School. She does a great job, by the way. And I also have my youngest is a kindergartner at Manatiquit. My oldest daughter started in 2011 at FDK at Braintree High School. She was in the original FDK class. So this year marks my 9,000th dollar to full day kindergarten. So if anybody has skin in the game, I guess you could say that I do. That being said, I also work in the construction industry. I am a telecommunications and security system integration foreman for an electrical contractor, and I've worked the past 11 years at various MSBA projects throughout the state. I currently am working at Winchester High School, where that project is $120 million. The reimbursement rate is $100 million, so the school has to pay $70 million because they have some added costs. I just finished Anger Elementary School in Newton, $27 million, brand new school, 20 odd classrooms, K through 5, media center, art room, art classroom, music, cafetorium, full size gym, $27 million. Reimbursement was about 14. That's what the town picked up. Also, Newton, right down the street, Zervis Elementary School, they're doing a brand new school there. See, this is part of Newton's capital plan. They did Newton North High School a few years back. They did Burrover, right? They did Newton South about 15 years ago. I'm not saying that Braintree is Newton, okay? That's where I grew up. I went to Zervis. They're knocking my old elementary school down. And it reminds me a lot of Flaherty in a way, you know? I look at our schools, and working in the industry I do and what I do, they lack so much. They just lack so much in terms of technology, security. I can just knock on the door at an elementary school, say, hi, I'm here to pick up my kid, and the door is unlocked. Okay? At the new elementary schools they build today, there's actually glass windows. You buzz the door, you go into the vestibule. It's a man trap now, right? Then you go up to a sliding glass. There's the administrator asking you for your name. What's your child's name? They might actually ask you for identification. And then they buzz you through the next door to get you into the building, right? Anger for $27 million had all of those, and they had speech reinforcement in all the classrooms. The classrooms were very bright, LED lights, heat, air conditioning, probably 40 on-site CCTV cameras, access control for the staff, right? These are all things that lack in our schools. And to go into facilities that are just so out of date, we need to start at the ground up. Now, you looked at $28 to $35 million for 12 to 15 classrooms and a renovation of this building. For that same money, you can build a brand new elementary school, right? And if you're 2 to 5 years, you know, why don't we make it a 10-year plan with redoing elementary schools? Flaherty could be knocked to the ground. We could build an elementary school where the ball fields are, not interrupt any of the students as that construction's going on, and when it's done, you knock the building down. Putting a gymnasium on, what's that going to do? I asked my daughter today. She said she had clarinet today. And I said, oh, where'd you have clarinet? In the music room. I said, where's the music room? She said, the stage. I said, so the stage of what, your gym? Yeah. Where do they do gym? In the gym. Well, don't you eat there too? Yeah, we eat there too. So this is a problem. Putting a gym onto my elementary school is not going to solve the problem at Flaherty. It just isn't, right? And I would it would suffice to say that the Liberty School, the denial was based on how it was written. I read the SOI. It's online. You can clearly see it. 2015, right? It's there. Right? The SOI, when they ask, you know, I took a couple snapshots. It says, check off these boxes. So what was checked was elimination of existing severe overcrowding, prevention of severe overcrowding expected to result from increased enrollments, and replacement, renovation, or modernization of school facility systems, such as roof, windows, boilers, heatings, ventilation systems, etc. There was nothing checked off on this SOI that actually had anything to do with the space issues. And if you go through the SOI, all it talks about is how there's kids in rooms that shouldn't be classrooms, that they're learning in hallways, and the SOI had nothing to do with that. It was updating systems. So I would like the town of Braintree to really get serious, think of a 10-year plan, and if it includes building new elementary schools to come up to at least a 2000 level and not a 2016 level, it would be much appreciated. And I'd also like to say, just for the record, that Braintree is a blue-collar town. I myself am in construction, and a lot of my neighbors are in construction. And if there is a project that it does involve the MSBA, I would like the council to consider putting in a residency requirement for any construction project as to hire Braintree residents that live in this town to work in this town. Thank you for your time.
Good evening. My name is Laura Bronco. I am a parent of two daughters. I have a second grader at the Highland School. Hi, Dr. P. And we love the school very much. And I have a fifth grader who will be starting kindergarten in the fall. I guess I'm trying to take this all in. I have been since last year trying to hear all of this and understand it. I grew up in Brockton, not too far away. Not everyone right now would think of Brockton and think of, yay, awesome schools. But in the 70s, awesome schools. If I think about my elementary school, when I hear about Liberty, I actually was getting choked up. And to think that Braintree kids, that the conditions are as poor as they are for a town that is a good town and where home prices are high and where the scores are so great, I have to say, as much as I love Highlands and I love the staff and the heart and the soul of the school, as a parent going in there, I was just so deflated because I lived in the city and we sort of said, okay, when we're having a family and moving out to the burbs, where do we want to go? And we settled on Braintree. And one of the things you look at when you're looking at towns is scores. But the scores don't tell the whole picture. The scores don't show you that there is no place for art, that there is no library. And I think back to my elementary days, and the library in our school was phenomenal. And to get to go through the halls and go to another classroom to have art was amazing. Not to have a teacher come in with a cart and hand everybody some markers and paper, it's really not that much different than your homeroom teacher doing that for you. So I guess hearing all of this, you know, I've always wondered, is that just something that's gone forever? Will kids ever have that? And in hearing in the last couple of weeks about the idea of fifth graders moving up to the middle school, that frightened me for all the reasons we heard tonight as far as are they emotionally ready? And it's a tough world for, you know, for kids these days anyway, and to be so young and being exposed to those sixth, seventh, eighth graders, I'd love to hear more about what a school within a school entails. The word isolation doesn't sound very warm and fuzzy, but I can see how you'd want them to be isolated from eighth graders. And I think the idea of K through eight sounds nice, and maybe the older kids in K through eight look out for the little ones, but they've been in that community, in that sense of community in one school for a long time. But when they're in middle school, I just think they're, I can only imagine it's different. I think when you're in fifth grade in elementary school, you're finally the big fish in the pond, and you're the big kid, and you have a sense of community with the younger kids in that school. And then you are plopped in as the little ones in middle school, and I think it's different. I personally grew up, it was K, one through six, seventh and eighth were junior high, and then into high school, and that's what my comfort level was. So I guess coming to Braintree, seeing Highlands, which is always known as kind of the elementary school, and I was so excited about it. And again, you look at the scores and you make your choices, and then to see the facilities, it's the heart and soul is there. It's a wonderful place. I wouldn't want to move, but it makes me sad to think that on the one hand, I thought, well, that's great. Last year when my first grader started, there was some semblance of a library because the kindergarten had been moved to Manatequit. We're not sure what's happening next year. Now my kindergartner will be coming next year, either to Manatequit or Highlands. So on the one hand, it's nice to have K through whatever it might be together. But then my second grader now, they have a cart for a library, and they go into the one media room, and I know there were wires and cords, and Dr. Pelletier, they all work really hard to work with what they have. Like the lovely Liberty teacher said earlier, teachers make do. And the experience for the kids just shouldn't be all about the scores. I know the testing is important. I hear so much focus on that. But things like making our fifth graders move up, in all of these ways, we're making the kids grow up so fast. They're already growing up really fast these days. I tried to organize my thoughts as I was taking all this in, and I'm sorry I'm emotional. So other than wanting to hear about the school within the school idea and see how that might help, because it is very appealing to think of winning back some space in the elementary school to give kids the art, the special education, the learning specialists, and all the privacy and all the space that you need for different things that have to happen throughout the day, I still worry about the fifth graders moving. And I guess as far as the whole process, I know there's a process and hoops that have to be jumped through, and we want to get as much money from the state as we can. But to hear, well, there's, you know, Boston and our schools aren't crumbling, and there's Worcester and they're ahead of us. And it just makes me think, well, do we have to sit around and wait until the schools are crumbling and we need a railing in our room so kids aren't falling on the floors? Apparently, how bad do things have to get with the facilities before we can be higher in line? And I don't really want to wait that long till the schools are dangerous and falling apart. And what else can be done to raise the money some other way to, I don't know, that's where I draw a line, I don't know. Thank you. And thank you all for everything you do. I know it's not easy.
Thank you. Anyone else?
school. He's in third grade, so this will affect him, maybe, maybe not. But when he was going into first grade, we had one of these meetings about what to do with kindergarten, because we knew about a space problem back then. Now, fast forward 3 years, and here we are, we have another space problem. So now we need to move kids that are not ready to go into middle school. I know you guys are all saying that they'll be okay, it's a school within a school, but now my son will be taking the bus. Is he getting on the bus with the 6th, 7th, and 8th graders? I don't want him on the bus with the 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. He's too young for those conversations that go on, for the language on the bus, maybe. So I think we need to look at this in the kids' perspective. I know we're trying to alleviate space problems, but we knew about these space problems years ago, and we're still trying to put Band-Aids on really big problems. And I think, you know, we have to submit something next week for what's going to be the plan of action. I don't think you gave everyone enough time to give their input into it. And I think there might be another solution, but obviously now we only have a week to come up with one. But I think we've had this issue on the table, and I think it kept getting skirted. And I think we do need to look at the emotional needs of the children, because isolating them within a school, like the woman that was just here that said, you know, in fifth grade, they're the big fish. They know that. They have all the fifth grade special activities, the graduation, the party, all special things that they do. And the younger kids look up to them. And now they're going to go to a school where they're little fish again. So they're not getting that big fish feeling. So I don't know. That's just my feeling.
Hi, my name is Jennifer Crandall. I'm a Braintree resident. My children are not yet in the schools. I have four-year-old twins, and I have a little girl who will be 2 in April. But I'm an educator, too, so I pay attention to the schools, and I know how happy people are with the schools in Braintree. I know all my neighbors are delighted that I'm in the Liberty Zone. I live maybe 10 houses over from Liberty. So I know the physical plant is not what it could be, but I know that people are also very happy with their instruction. I have to say, I'm happy to see a plan. I don't personally have a lot of opinions about where fifth grade is. My children aren't that age yet, so I sort of defer to people who are both more invested and knowledgeable about that age group. But we moved here in 2011, and the space needs report came out, and then it was modular classrooms, and we have to decide right away, and we're going to open the kindergarten center. So these issues have been going on for a while. So I am happy, welcome to Braintree, to see the long, like, elements of a longer-term plan here that address so many of the needs. I just, like some of the others, want to be certain that the elementary schools don't get lost in this, because I know there's been consistently a concern that there isn't the funding available to do some of the things that have been recommended in this space needs report, because I know that one thing that made the difference between what was considered an acceptable versus an unacceptable solution was that it wasn't enough to just add on, that we actually need substantial renovation to the existing plant. So as you develop that longer plan, which, again, I'm not certain, but I think in the Liberty SOI, we couldn't check off that box that we had a long-term plan. So I hope that that long-term plan is developing, but that there's a real attention to the needs of the elementary schools in that plan, too, as well as the middle and high schools. So there are so many things to consider, but it's not just additions that we need. We do really need the existing facilities maintained and improved. So, thanks.
Hi, my name is Jane Foley. I have students, children at Flaherty and at East. I work in a school system as well, and I just want to say thank you. You've done a great job. You're not going to please everyone. We have learned that our staff and students will rise above. Your children are all going to be safe. They will be ready for progression. Any progress any positivity trickles down. We will be fine. We're in good hands, and I just want to say thanks and welcome Dr. Hackett.
Good evening. My name is Kara Wishart, and I have taught fifth grade at Liberty for 22 years. I also have two children who are I have two children who are currently in the Braintree schools, an eighth grader and a tenth grader. So I've had children that were fifth grade age, and I've known that age group for a long time. I again want to thank you for having a vision and for having a plan. And Jane, what Jane just said, I was here a few years ago when we listened to very nervous kindergarten parents about entering a kindergarten center. And I was only here in support because, like I said, at that point, my children were already through Highlands Kindergarten. However, I listened to those parents and I heard their passion and they were nervous and they were scared. And I don't know about you, but all I hear about Manatequit Kindergarten is it is the place to be. So you did an amazing job. So I know change is difficult. I know it's not easy. As a fifth grade teacher, I won't speak for everyone. I will speak for my colleagues at Liberty. We'd be excited because Manatequit opening and they did such amazing things and they were, you know, the forerunners of that project. We would be excited to explore. I was talking to Jennifer Fabiers of the Professional Development, and we're not talking tomorrow. We're not talking this happening tomorrow without being planned. We're talking 3 or 4 years down the road. It will be so well planned out and so well done. And as far as I know, it's scary to think your fifth grader is with a big, scary eighth grader. But I want to say this, and I'm sorry if I should or should not, but at the end of the day, some fifth graders don't say very nice things to first graders. So they take some innocence away too. I know it's not a nice thing to think about, but any age range is difficult. So again, as you heard earlier, we're in an emergency situation. I mean, Liberty cannot take, we got 10 new students in the past month. I mean, I got a new student today. It's just insane. So something needs to happen for the younger kids at Liberty. I would hate to leave my colleagues, but you need to look at the big picture, and I think that's the best advice we can go with right now. And as a taxpayer in this town, and everyone had great ideas, and I would love to see this big, beautiful school too, but this town has voted down an override several times. And I'm personally embarrassed about that. So we can look at big, beautiful schools, but if we're not going to vote for an override, it's not going to happen. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Leif Maggio. I'm a speech pathologist at Flaherty School, and I have two daughters at Morrison. We moved here because Braintree is wonderful. This is my 11th year working here. I've worked with many of you. I don't know if many of the people here know this, but the middle school in particular has some wonderful, substantially separate classrooms that serve our special education population. Right now, they serve grades 6, 7, and 8, and they do a fantastic job. And the teachers and the therapists work very hard. And I want to make sure that there's a plan in place to continue to serve all special education students at the level that they're being served now with the appropriate staffing. Because if you have a school within a school and you're just having a fifth grade, who is going to service those fifth grade students when the program runs 6, 7, 8? And I want to ensure for my students who are moving to middle school that I can sit in an IEP meeting with their parents and say, yes, we have this in place. We know who's going to be servicing your child and that it's going to be seamless. And your child will also have the opportunities to integrate with peers as appropriate, which is what the middle school is doing right now. And if you add 240 students to, let's say, East, you're going to stress out your special educators and your therapists and your nurse and your principals. And that's a lot of children to add. Do you have enough space, but are you going to have enough staff? And I would, as a teacher and a parent, I would like to know the answer to that before you move forward. Thank you.
Great questions. you know, I would want to address that, I think, specifically. I mean, I think we are in a community, and my experience here in a very short period of time has been staffing is the priority for all kids. And I, you know, can sit here and tell you with a pretty high level of confidence that this community of parents, of teachers, of educators, of administrators wouldn't settle for anything but the appropriate staffing for all of our kids. I think that there are advantages of having more kids in the same location who have shared needs, in that from a staffing perspective, there is an economy of scale that you can realize when that happens. So we talk about, and I never said isolated, by the way, just for the record, we talk about a school within a school. That doesn't necessarily mean that there wouldn't be some shared staffing happening across various specialty areas, whether it be special education services, OT, PT, whether it be art, music, foreign languages. The sharing of staff could still happen. I mean, students would be here at the same time. How they spend their day and where they spend their day would be subject to a plan that we'd be working on, as someone pointed out, for the next 2 or 3 years. That plan, that curriculum, and how that looks isn't my decision. It's a decision of staff. It's a decision of parents. It's a decision of the people we bring together in the transition process as we prepare for students to be part of this wonderful school here at East, which if we had another 3 hours, I would let the principal talk about how wonderful East is, because he's very good at that. So, and deservedly so. Would you like to? Absolutely. Yeah, we don't have 3 hours, though.
I just want to make one comment. First of all, I just want to thank Leif for those comments. I just want to let you know that, you know, as a principal at East Middle School, I have many of the same questions that you have. So when Ms. Maggio came up here and asked a question about staffing, I asked the same questions to Dr. Hackett. You need to know, as far as I'm concerned, I'm not just a soldier standing in line doing whatever Dr. Hackett tells me to do and saying whatever. Right. I want what's best for our students at East, and that means 6, 7, 8, and if it's 5, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I'm going to push back on things that I don't think sound okay. I am the principal of this school. But first and foremost, I'm an advocate for your children. And I need you to know that their safety, physical and emotional safety, is the priority for me. So please trust that myself, Mr. Rainey, we have your children's best interest at heart, and we're going to push back when it doesn't sound right. Okay?
I just wanted to echo some of the sentiments. Oh, sorry, I'm Jen Dolan. I'm the parent of a Flaherty student, a very happy Flaherty student. And I wanted to echo some of the positive sentiments that people have brought up. I'm really excited that there's a plan. You know, I understand that there's been a lot of pent-up frustration from folks who have sort of been in this process for many years, and I can appreciate that for sure. I think we're taking advantage of an opportunity that's right in front of us. And I think we'd be foolish to pass it by. I can't imagine that, you know, as people have said, if we left millions of dollars on the table, there might be another whole auditorium full of people ready to wring the necks of people who voted that down. So I think that, you know, we have to be a little bit scrappy. It's not a perfect solution, but we need to move forward. And I think that, you know, were we to reject this plan, it doesn't solve a lot of the things that people have brought up. You know, it doesn't automatically make that money available for the types of renovations and repairs that we want. And so I would hope, as the teacher had brought up, that we might, you know, have to look again at an override. And I would hope that all the people in this auditorium who are so eager, you know, for all of these capital improvements would be right on that committee trying to help that happen. If we want an influx of cash, that's where it's going to come from. So I hope that people are ready for that. Buckle up. But it's important. The last part I wanted to say was some of the concerns with the fifth graders being in with the eighth graders. I feel like sometimes we're forgetting that these eighth graders are our neighbors. They are the kids in our community that you see out riding their bikes.
They are the older siblings of your children. And I think if we're viewing them as predators or as these horrible influences, I mean, not for nothing, that should be addressed on its own if that's what we think about the eighth graders. Like, that's not good for eighth graders either. So, you know, I think we need to keep that in mind and, you know, certainly trust the people that we've put in place to lead our children and keep them safe and keep them happy. And I, for one, am thrilled to be a part of the school system. Thanks.
Could I just take a moment? Could I just offer a thought before, if you don't mind, just for a sec? I just want to take a moment. Joe Sullivan, fortunate to serve as mayor, and I came here, as we all did, to listen to these comments. The term override has been used, and I want to address that in a moment in terms of, you know, the options associated with funding the plan that we would look to put in place. But first, I do want to say that as mayor and as a member of the school committee, I appreciate everyone coming out tonight and offering their thoughts. And I can tell you that over the past couple of years, as we've all worked to meet this challenge of the growing enrollment within our schools, we have thought, I think, in a very comprehensive way of how best we can approach this. I want to thank Dr. Hackett for his work. You know, he was chosen to come in and give us a fresh perspective, and he's been able to do this. And he's been able to work through a situation in his previous community where he had these types of similar challenges. And quite frankly, knowing that we had these challenges here in Braintree, he's the reason, or one of the reasons, or one of the attributes, I should say, that we brought him in. And I think he's demonstrated with a very thoughtful plan for us to look at. In putting together his plan, I know, because I spent many hours with him, as did other members of this committee, we considered many of the options that you are now offering us. And I say that with respect and appreciation because you've thought as well, since this proposal was put forth last Monday night, is there another way to do it? I think that the plan currently being offered essentially is a realignment in how we will offer education throughout the district. A realignment in terms of 1 to 4, 5 to 8, and then 9 to 12. And by looking at the expansion opportunity that we have here at East, and also having that further discussion with South in terms of the addition of classrooms, what essentially we are doing is we are freeing up space in 22 classrooms at the elementary level. So in the next 3 to 5 years, we shift the fifth grade into the middle school. We have the opportunity then to accommodate our growing enrollment at the elementary level, and we have funding available because we've been consistent in that funding, and we will continue to do so to take the repair, to do the repairs necessary at our elementary schools as well. You know, we know, both my kids attended Braintree Public Schools. We have members of this committee who, by the way, are volunteers, and they do a lot of work, and they're very thoughtful, but they're parents as well. And they've thought through this as well as we've all looked at this challenge that we face. I've said this before in many meetings that we've had, and can I just say this? I've never missed a school committee meeting. That's how important it is for me as mayor to be at these meetings. I want to get perfect attendance when the time I'm through, I hope. But it's important that we have this discussion, and it's important that everyone understand that what you're talking about emotionally and specifically to your children, we take to heart, and we understand what you're thinking about because we've been there ourselves, because for many of us, we've been parents, and we understand. And I think as John Sheehan said and as Dr. Hackett has outlined, our primary goal is to make sure not only are your kids learning, but are they going to be in a safe and warm environment. The security that we have at our schools today is much more pronounced than it ever has been. Subsequent to Newtown, Connecticut, we have our police officers visiting each one of our elementary schools every single day. We do have a security and system in place. The work that we've done with capital improvements, we got a lot of inventory, folks, to catch up to. We've spent $17 million in the last 8 years. That's over $2 million a year on capital improvements to our schools, and we need to do more. In terms of the specific question asked about an override, I've done the studies. I've looked at the material more recently. We've had three override attempts and two debt exclusions, and none of them have passed. We have to be mindful of that. We have reserves. We've not yet made a determination how we would finance this plan because we've not yet come up with the full plan. That's why we're having this discussion. It would be premature tonight to bring a finance plan to the community without fully understanding what the plan is going to be. So getting this in place, filing the feasibility study for $263,000, which I've already done, the members of the town council are here, and that vote will take place on February 23rd. Once you take these sequential steps, then we will have that further discussion of how we would put in place the financial underpinnings to make this plan work. As was noted by Dr. Hackett in the chat, the MSBA is not going to make a determination on whether or not we can fully go forward until January of 17. So prior to that, and then once that approval is given, and we know specifically how much of a percentage that we can secure from the MSBA, then we will have a financial plan that we'll have to work on and either bring back to the community in the spring in terms of being able to fund it and the funds that we currently have available, or whether or not there might have to be a ballot referendum. But I will say to you tonight, we will not have an override. There may be a debt exclusion that we would look at as an option. Now, a debt exclusion is a specific time frame associated with specific capital improvements. It's essentially a second mortgage on your home, in this case, on our schools. And it would be clearly laid out in terms of how we would approach that. But I don't make that commitment tonight. I don't think any of us could do that. It would be unfair. We need to understand fully, number one, the acceptance of this plan as it relates to school enrollment, and then number two, the MSBA's approval so that we can come back with a final finance plan for the committee to look at. Overrides are generally done for operating purposes, and they're done for communities that need additional funding that are going to carry on forever and forever and forever. In our case, and I think it's a hallmark of one of the things we've tried to do with our new government, we have managed our finances pretty well. We do have healthy reserves, and we can use some of those reserves to offset any type of referendum question on a debt exclusion that we may, and I underline the word may because we're not there yet, I have to bring to our community. The relationship that we have with MSBA is a strong one. And when they hit the reset button for us officially last Wednesday, and Dr. Hackett and Representative Cusack were at the meeting with me in Boston, they said that day, I wish you were there, because they said this is a great opportunity for us to work with a community that is being thoughtful about an enrollment issue and a challenge issue that they're facing. We're not just plowing ahead with a renovation project. We're seriously thinking about doing this expansion because we have the opportunity today to do that expansion. And I believe if we do this well, and with the professionals we have, not only the teachers, the paraprofessionals, the cafeteria workers, the custodians, the principals, we have a great team, and we can make this work successfully. And the MSBA recognizes that. We're a community they want to do business with. So what we have to do is come up with our comprehensive plan, make sure that it addresses the challenges that we face in the area of enrollment, and then get to the finance issue. And those are the steps that we're taking, I think, in a methodical, pragmatic, and hopefully, and I believe, in the best interest of our school children. If we put this plan together today, our schools will be transformed, not only in the next 3 to 5 years, but by 2025. Over the next decade, those of you who have a child either just born, there was a young woman who spoke about a 9-month-old who's the teacher in Hingham, that child will have the greatest educational opportunity because over the next 3 to 5 years, we'll expand our middle schools, we'll pay more attention because we'll have the ability to do so financially and otherwise to our elementary schools. That next generation will have a tremendous experience. I'm a product of the Braintree schools. I think that I was educated pretty well. I probably could have been a little bit better than my teachers, but overall I did pretty well from a standpoint of getting a good education, and we want that to continue here in Braintree. Everyone up here shares your concerns. We want to work with you to make this happen in the best interest, in the best long-term interest of our community. Thank you.
I'm going to ask two questions. I wanted to echo the concern about the four schools going into one middle school and two to the other, and I assume that's on projected building in the future, which seems like it's all going to happen in the Liberty neighborhood. But I was wondering if there's any data to show that and what the thought process is there. And then I think Mr. Mayor just spoke about this, but if it seems like the East project, there's a very strict timeline, but with South, it's a little vague at this point. So is there any chance that East would be done and South wouldn't, and would some fifth graders be moved and some not? So if you could just speak to those, that would be great. Thank you.
I'll just speak. We need to have a comprehensive plan. If the MSBA is going to approve East, which I believe they will, we're going to have to come up with a plan in terms of South, and we're going to move concurrently with our plan in terms of South with feasibility. We've already introduced to the MSBA the opportunity with a statement of interest that we will file this year for South. We may not get approval this year, but we're going to keep at it. And we've already communicated with them, and they understand the comprehensive nature of our approach. They understand that we're moving forward on East with an educational plan, not just a renovation plan now, and that that needs to be coupled with South. They've not given any type of sign off. They've not given any type of commitment. And as we saw before, once you have one in the queue, it's difficult to get a second one accepted. However, we've had some communication with them, and I believe we can have some more conversations to see whether or not they would participate, perhaps at a lower level, or perhaps as a community, we need to step up and fully fund that. So those are the types of financial options that we'll be looking at as we build this relationship with the MSBA. So it's not fair tonight to give you a full answer on that, but I think from where we sit and the conversations I've had with Dr. Hackett, in terms of making this plan work, we need to make sure that East and South have fifth grade realignment.
Just to kind of, you know, the first part of the question, I think it's important to remember that we are talking really about the difference between what we do now in bringing all of Hollis to East. So when you look at the numbers, what it would look like with current enrollments in 5 through 8, there's about 140 kid student difference between what the total population would be at East and what the total population would be at South. So, you know, just to give you some numbers around it, which I think also provides some perspective too, you know, East is the larger middle school because it does currently have more schools that do feed into it. So we're really talking about that difference between that half, the split, at Hollis that would be enrolled in the future at East.
My name is Wendy Heidenreich. I'm a parent at Liberty School. I have a second grader and a fourth grader. I just wanted to ask a few questions about Liberty School. Now that the statement of interest has been denied, I understand that, you know, this proposal would free up some classrooms in 2019. But you heard Mrs. Wells speak about how dire we are in need of space at the moment. And I just wonder, I know that you're not in favor of modular classrooms, but is that a consideration, or are there any other types of considerations that could be thought about in the shorter term?
So the short answer would be yes. You know, I think that there's modular classroom construction has happened in Braintree that it has been used in more of a permanent space way. And I think, you know, South is one good example. There are other examples of units that were modularly constructed, but they weren't, but they're permanent. You know, they have a longer lifespan than what you would think of as what we talk about portable units. We're talking then about kind of the traditional double wide, two classrooms, bathroom shared in the middle space that you really are looking at for hopefully no more than a 3 or 4 or 5 year life, because you're getting ready for a construction project or you're moving. It's temporary space. So, you know, I know that we certainly are aware of the pressures at Liberty. We're looking at that right now as part of our budget process, an analysis of what's incoming, what's currently there, what are our options, and you know that would be part of the budget process, which would be separate, really separate and apart from the conversation we're having tonight. But I would go back to the comment that I made earlier that I do think any long-term plan needs to really consider ways to reduce the overall enrollment at Liberty, or at least contain and control for it. So yes, short answer, we would be looking at space, what's needed for next year, what we might have to propose as part of our budget process.
Hi, Patty Rust. I have three children in the school system, and I'm very excited to see a plan, as other people have mentioned. Just curious, though, was it considered, you know, we could take the money, add on to East and South as planned, East first, I know South hopefully will come, and convert the middle to elementary and have eight elementary and go back to a 1-8 system. I know you've mentioned that, Dr. Hackett, that that's your experience. That's where I come from as well. And personally, I prefer that. So just wondering if that was considered.
Great question. I think, you know, part of the challenge with this is right now the project that is in front of the MSBA that has been approved and that we're asking for consideration for the expansion is addressing 5-8. That's where the plan is. That's where the money would come from to fund that project. The MSBA would not look kindly on us changing that at this point, I don't believe. I think that, you know, for us to say we're gonna build a five, we're gonna bring the fifth grade, wink, wink, and then all of a sudden we turn into a K-8, I would imagine that the people from the MSBA would be wondering what happened and probably talking about whether or not they're gonna continue to fund us. So we have to work with the rules that we have, the parameters that we have in front of us. Again, I think for all the reasons that you heard, I do believe this is the right solution that's in front of us right now that we should take advantage of. I am certainly recommending that we take advantage of this. All the comments that were made about the other priorities and things that we need to do, this doesn't stop here for us. You know, there's a lot of work to be done. The mayor, I think, said it very well. You know, so this is one piece, a big piece, of the solution for us to continue to try to improve our facilities. And I think the gentleman who spoke earlier, who's done a lot of work on MSBA projects, you know, in a perfect world, and we didn't have any schools at all, we were starting from scratch, we probably would build four brand new elementary schools, and we probably would do that. But I can tell you probably that that's not going to be an option for us for the foreseeable future. And so once we get through this piece of it, can alleviate some of the space constraints that we're realizing, it leverages us to also utilize resources that otherwise might have gone into other things to try to really focus on the remaining pieces that we need to address at the elementary level. Again, I think really space is one. You know, and the other capital improvements is another pot, and sometimes they're funded differently. So the question is, if there's only so much money, how do you do it? If there's a group of parents that wants to get together and put together an override, debt exclusion, excuse me, for capital improvements, then my number is 781. But thank you.
Hello, I'm Carrie Piccolo. I have two kids at Morrison Elementary School and loved hearing the presentation again, Dr. Hackett. I am still not sold on this plan. We're talking about restructuring Braintree. And the money, I know you just mentioned the fiscal, the budgetary things, Mr. Mayor, but if you look at what's in this proposal, and there's a $35 million project at East on the table, with the MSBA partnering 58% possibly. That's $20 million. That seems like a lot, but there's other components of this project. It's not just East, it's South, another $12 million, which is questionable if we'll get funding for that. Plus, in this proposal, there's $4 million for a gym and a cafeteria on two elementary schools. So you're up to like $31 million on a plan that the town will have to fund that much money. It's $50 million with $20 million back, so it's a $31 million plan. And I just think we might be able to focus K-5 on the K-5 schools with that $31 million versus restructuring our entire town to fit this MSBA opportunity. So so I'm actually asking you to vote no for this proposal. Nobody's actually asked that question yet, but I'm not sold on it. I don't want the town restructured.
I didn't say restructured. I said realignment. That's what I said in terms of the 1 to 4 and the 5 to 8.
Well, that's restructuring.
Okay.
It's semantics. But anyway, I feel strongly that K through 5 is a solid start to our schools. And even if you don't feel that way, restructuring or realigning our town within 6 weeks is a big move, and I'm just asking for your consideration to maybe not use this MSBA proposal, and as someone else already pointed out, come up with a big idea for our town. And we know Dr. Hackett could come up with this in 6 weeks. If we, you know, given more time, he might even have a better plan for Braintree. So, thank you.
Anyone else?
We tried to get funding for all the elementary schools, and MSBA turned us down. From 2007 to date, we submitted, if I'm not mistaken, submitted an SOI every single year but 1 year, and they turned it down every year. So we tried that route, and we're basically said they're not going to partner with us on that. So we're at this point.
She's saying don't, yeah.
Sorry?
She's saying don't use the MSBA money, just go alone.
You could get $4 million per elementary school with this plan and $8 million for East to start doing something tomorrow, and it would be on our own agenda, and we could get it started before September if we don't use the MSBA, because the MSBA plans take 2 years. We have money. We have problems. So that, I'm just asking you to consider it. That's all.
Hello. Sarah DeMeo, Hollis Mom. I just have a question. Just to close the book on the Habib study, because I haven't been following this closely. I only moved to town several years ago for the schools and the taxes. But I do want to know more about the Habib study and why each of those choices was rejected a few years ago and why they've all been discarded now. Because it was my understanding that a study cost quite a bit. I would imagine there wasn't sticker shock. We know what these things cost, and they were all between $60 and $70 million, so that's 10, 12 a school. Was that because they were all dependent on MSBA money? Or, again, just before we move forward, and I do feel better about the 5 to 8 plan, having been here tonight, I share concerns that everyone's been talking about tonight, but I do feel better about it. I do have great trust in the educators. I like hearing that there will probably be a long planning and transition period where there'll be a lot of input, and we'll make sure we do it right. But again, just what happened to those options that were on the table a few years ago? Why did we not move forward, and then why were they rejected now? Thank you.
To respond, the MSBA really never gave us, you know, a full accounting as to why they didn't like it. They had indicated that they didn't think the Habib study was as, I guess the best word I can say is was as organized or was going to be as positive for the community as looking at other options. We had gone about looking at the Habib, retaining Habib to help us look at our schools specifically without talking to the MSBA, just to look internally at how we could approach this. But the MSBA's response to it, the only thing I can tell you was not positive. They really didn't like the way in which the plan was drawn up. They didn't think a school-by-school-by-school program was going to be as successful as looking at it much more comprehensively. And they also indicated, as we found out with Liberty, that annual SOIs, statement of interest, would probably not be endorsed. So in a nutshell, we were thinking, and I think it's prudent to think, if there's some state financial assistance available, we should be looking to access it. You know, we had done South Middle School. We had done that project in 2011. It was a renovation project. At that time, we specifically said we're going to do South first, and we're going to come back to East. And as Dr. Hackett outlined, in looking at the history and all the work we had done, we were going to keep that commitment to do East. And in doing the East commitment in terms of a renovation project, they said to us in conversations about the growing enrollment, what if we looked at an educational project? And I don't want to get repetitive here, but basically an educational project is classroom expansion. And that's when we paused. Dr. Hackett did all of the analysis and reaching out to many folks and trying to discover the best route possible. And we went back to the MSBA and said, let's take this opportunity. And so that's what transpired over the course of the last couple of weeks, most recently Wednesday. And that's what's gotten us into this path to move forward on a feasibility study so that we grow the educational component here. We, I think, solve what is a growing problem, a challenge with our enrollment. And then we look to go to South. And, you know, we have $20 million available to us. It seems to me that we should look to try to access that funding.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Anybody else? No?
Well, thank you all. No?
You guys were so done. We were so close to being done. Sorry.
I'm like, I was a late bloomer. I know. Okay, so hello, I'm Geraldine Lannon, and I'm not very good at this, so I apologize. But thank you, thank you, thank you. Just a couple things. I was just wondering if, and I kind of think I know the answer, but if they had ever thought about doing 5th and 6th at one school and 7th and 8th at another. But I think it's school size. That becomes an issue with that. The other thing is 5th, 6th, and 7th, and 8th graders go to high school. There's a lot of room there. So I just think it's nice to think about other things.
Agreed. You know, I can still say this as someone who's still relatively new. I came into this school system excited about all this work, and I remain very excited about this work, and I remain very excited about the possibilities. You know, with all due respect, you're a community with too many options. You've got too much on the table, and so much of it isn't really doable, in my view, okay? My professional opinion, knowing the process, understanding how this stuff works, understanding what it means to put 6 elementary schools under construction, one of which is already at not enough space for the physical, actual green space for the population it has. Someone has to come in, and I'm going to let that be me, and you can all blame me, but someone had to come in my opinion, and say at some point, this is the best possible solution at this point in time. So much of what many of you have said makes perfect sense. So much of what many of you said has been considered for many, many years. There are smart, good people up here who have done a ton of work on this issue for many years. The fact of the matter is, right now, we have an opportunity. We have a chance to get $20 million. And with all due respect to Carrie, who I spent a nice, lovely morning with, having coffee, and talking about some of this stuff, $20 million is a lot of money. Several years ago, there was a plan put forward to the community to do much of what you just talked about in terms of expanding the elementary schools, and it was voted down. That was one of the debt exclusions that the mayor referenced earlier that was voted down. So I think my job, I know my job, was to try to come up with the best possible feasible solution that takes care of the kids that we have in front of us as quickly as possible and long term. We could talk we probably could spend another 3 hours coming up with additional options. 5, 6, 7, 8, some schools do that. Professionally, I'm coming from a community with a 7-8 middle school, and all we did was transition kids into 7th and then transition them out of 8. It became a transition school. Bringing kids from 6th grade into 7th, and then bringing them from 8th to the high school, the constant feedback was that parents, teachers just didn't feel like they had the time to really get to know the kids and the families in the way that they would hope that they could. And that configuration was driven by space. School systems across the Commonwealth are making determinations about their configurations based on what's available. And we are in that situation. So from my perspective, again, I mean, I think this is the best recommendation. I think it's a very good recommendation. I wouldn't be here suggesting this if I didn't think it was, for all the reasons that we've talked about tonight. And we will make this work, and not only will make it work, we'll make it work very, very well. And I do appreciate, you know, all the consideration and the suggestions, and I know that much of, I need you to know, that in talking to people who are up here, so much of what you've said tonight has been talked about, has been considered. And just because it hasn't been public, and now we're up against a timeline, and some of you, respectfully, are here for the first time, and you're engaged in what happened, just know that you've got really good people who have spent a lot of time on this on your behalf for many years.
Hi, thank you for everything that you've done for the, you know, restructure is not the word I'm supposed to use, but
yeah,
you know, with the schools. I am not personally.
Let me clarify that. Yeah. I'm not, when I heard the word restructure, I was thinking, you know, construction. I've been going all day now, so it's getting late for me, I guess.
But, I know.
So realignment, restructure, you're right.
Okay. So, I mean, I'm happy that there's a plan and we're moving forward for sure. I'm not a fan of putting the fifth grade into the middle school personally. I just, for so many different factors that have already been said tonight. However, for me personally, it affects us just being the Hollis South District. I have 4 children in the school system, and I had 3 children, 2 who are currently still at Hollis, one who is at South Middle School who will be moving on. And I know that there are a small number of children. They might be 150 to 200 children, but there are children. And we've made a home with South, and we've made a, you know, connections with the teachers, and we know what's coming next, and we're part of a community. And to pull all those children out and move them to a new school, I agree. I think that I just don't feel like the pendulum is, you know, level there. And I truly believe that both South and East is such a safe haven for those kids coming in. I really do. I was so nervous as a parent sending my 6th grader to middle school. Terrified, really, to be honest with you. And I can't believe how well they did transferring those children from, you know, elementary school to middle school. They did a phenomenal job, and they had a great experience. And my friends who are at East say the same. I'm just afraid if we put too many kids into one school, we're going to lose that leverage. And that's where my major concern is right now. So.
Excuse me, can I ask your name, please? I'm sorry. Thank you. Anyone else? Going once, going twice?
We've had 20 speakers.
Okay. I would like to thank you all very much for coming here tonight, sharing your concerns and your questions. We really do appreciate it, and we'll take everything that you've said under advisement. Our next meeting will be on Monday, February 8th. It's currently scheduled at Colbert, but I think we're going to move it to Flaherty. Is that correct?
Yes.
So it'll be at Flaherty at 7 o'clock. Again, Monday, February 8th at 7 o'clock. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
I have a motion by Mr. Devon, a second by Mr. Kokoris. A roll call. Mr. Chafe, Mr. Kokoris, Mr. Devon.
Aye.
Mayor Sullivan.
Aye.
Mr. Ringus.
Aye.
Ms. Naughton. Aye. And the chair votes aye.
Yeah, ma'am.